So for the last few classes, we have been discussing about the two different types of RC circuit, namely the RC low pass circuit and RC high pass circuit. And we have also seen the response resulting from that circuit upon the application of some standard inputs like step function, then the pulse waveform, a rectangular waveform, and then the triangular waveform. Now, already we have mentioned that this type of circuit, let me just start today's discussion with some brief recapitulation. We have already mentioned that this circuit, you have this RC network. This RC network, and side by side, let me draw the second one. So this one is the high pass, the second one is the high pass, as you know. So let me apply some input over here, Vin, between these two nodes, and accordingly you'll be getting some output Vout. So this is the circuit number one, and similarly for the circuit number two, if I follow the same convention like Vin and Vout. So from our discussion, as you know, this circuit one, the first circuit, is nothing but a low pass network. It will only pass the low frequency component, and accordingly the response was something like that. If I very briefly mention it over here, so let it be mod A. It's a low pass with a higher cutoff frequency FH, and for this one we do have just the opposite response, and it looks something like that. And accordingly we do have the lower cutoff frequency, that is FL. And interestingly, what we have seen is FH, the higher cutoff frequency pertaining to the low pass filter, is given by 1 by twice pi RC. And similarly, the lower cutoff frequency pertaining to this high pass network was also the same, that is 1 by twice pi RC. So this is a low pass network, or we can also call like a low pass filter LPF. And this one is known as the high pass filter HPF. Now, as you understand, the bandwidth or the cutoff frequency of these two networks are heavily dependent upon the individual components, that is R and C. This cutoff frequency, it is inversely proportional to the RC product, both for the low pass network as well as for the high pass network. Now, let us consider a situation where this RC time constant or RC product for this low pass filter, let us assume that this RC product pertaining to this low pass filter is much, much large. Suppose RC is very, very large with respect to the time of the input signal. So if I consider that RC, that product, is much, much large with respect to the time, let me consider an input signal like this. Suppose this is my input signal. Suppose the input signal looks like that. A simple pulse waveform with a pulse width, say capital T. So this is the same input signal which has been applied both in circuit one as well as in circuit two. Now, if this RC product for this low pass filter, if that product is very, very large with respect to this time, that is capital T, much, much larger as compared to capital T, what does it mean? That means the higher cutoff frequency pertaining to this low pass filter is shifting towards the origin, because this RC product is inversely proportional to the higher cutoff frequency, that is FH. Now, if RC is much, much larger as compared to this window, that is capital T, then obviously this FH will be shifting towards the origin. That means this particular low pass filter will allow only a very small range of frequency to pass through it. In other words, the corresponding bandwidth of the low pass filter is getting reduced if I select a very high value of time constant, that is RC. Now, that intuition we can always apply whenever we analyze the circuit from different perspective. Now, as we apply an input signal between these two nodes, and we have a resistance over here and we have a capacitor over here. So you know that whenever we apply a waveform like a pulse waveform like this, then the capacitor initially, the capacitor is uncharged, for example. So that so this V out was zero. And whenever this pulse waveform is being applied, then the voltage across the capacitor is developed. And as you know, this development of the voltage will take place exponentially. We'll be having that particular formula. If I call this point to be at V, if this peak is at V, this one, then accordingly, the exponential formula V into 1 minus e to the power minus t upon RC. So that is the expression for the output voltage. And accordingly, the voltage across the capacitor will also increase exponentially. Now, what happens if the RC time constant is much, much larger as compared to the time duration of the pulse? It suggests that the capacitor charges very slowly. So whatever be the input signal you apply over here, the input signal gets divided into two different components. One is the voltage drop across the resistance, and second one is the output voltage or the voltage drop across the, or voltage difference between the two plates of the capacitor. So VR plus VC is nothing but Vin, and VC is equal to V out. Now, what happens if the capacitor charges very slowly, if the time constant is much, much larger with respect to the this pulse width of the pulse? Then this entire input voltage will essentially be applied across the resistance. What I mean to say is that out of these two components, VR and VC, the Vin is approximately equal to VR if the time constant is much, much larger. That means we can say we have two different components over here. So Vin can be written like VR plus V out or VC. Now, if the time constant is much, much larger with respect to the time duration of the pulse, or pulse width, then we may think that this VR can be approximately like Vin. So now, if I want to observe the corresponding current and voltage relationship at the output terminal, then you'll find that for any capacitor, the corresponding relationship between the input and the output, I mean, the current and voltage relationship on a capacitor can be represented like the voltage across the capacitor is equal to 1 upon C integration over I t dt. So if I just consider the voltage across the capacitor, and which is equal to the output voltage in this particular case, then we may write Vc that is equal to Vout is given by 1 by C integration over It dt. Now that is true always, irrespective of the value of the time constant, RC time constant with respect to the duration of the pulse. Now if the time constant is much larger with respect to the pulse width, then as we have already established that this entire Vin voltage will be developed or will be appearing across the resistance, then the current that is flowing through the circuit, that is It, so then this It, so the current that is flowing through this loop, let this be It. Now if the time constant is much larger with respect to t, then this It, when flowing across the resistance R, will be developing a voltage that is R times It. And under the condition that RC is much greater than capital T, then this VR, that is equal to R times It, is equal to Vin. So therefore, this It can be written like Vin by R. Now, if you put this value over here, then that is equal to 1 upon RC integration V in T dt. The condition is that provided the RC time constant is much larger as compared to the pulse width. So in fact, this is the output voltage as a function of time. So we should write V out as a function of time is equal to 1 upon RC integration V in T dt. So I should put this here as well. So a simple low pass filter consisting of a resistance and a capacitor can give you the notion of an integrator circuit. The output voltage, so if I just observe this entire RC low pass network as a black box, and if I provide an input like this, suppose this input being applied is Vin and the output obtained over is Vout, then with this RC low pass network with RC much greater than the pulse width, then this Vout T can be written like an integration of V in T multiplied with some constant, that is 1 by RC, which is there outside. So that means this low pass filter will perform the operation of an integrator circuit whenever the RC time constant is much larger. Now, whenever you provide an input signal like a pulse waveform like this, so this is the input signal that you are applying, V in T, and the pulse width is capital T. Suppose this point is V. So as you know, the output voltage will develop exponentially, and the formula for the output voltage, already we have mentioned this formula, this output voltage V out T can be written like V into 1 minus e to the power minus t by RC without any assumption. Now with the assumption that RC is much larger with respect to the time, then this e to the power minus t by RC can be approximated like 1 minus t by RC, because e to the power x can be written like 1 plus x if x is small. Now here t upon RC, now RC is large, so e to the power x can be approximately written like 1 plus x. So here Now, V out P can be written like V into T by RC. And if we just observe the corresponding variation of the output voltage, in fact, it will be increasing exponentially. But if the time constant is much larger, then that exponential variation can be approximated by means of a triangular, a linear fluctuation like this. While this value, if I call this value to be, say, Vp, if I call this value to be Vp, so V in T or V out T, I should not write like dash, because otherwise it may create some confusion. V in T or V out T. So I am plotting both the input and output on the same graph. So this Vp can be written like V into capital T by RC. If I just put the value of T is equal to capital T in this particular expression, that can be approximated. That means the exponential variation can be simply written like a linear variation. And then there will be fall of the output voltage. And once again, you know, this fall can be represented like this Vp into e to the power minus T minus capital T by RC. And once again, if this RC is much, much larger, because you are using the same circuit, so the RC product is much larger with respect to the pulse width. So that fall is also linear. So both the rise of the input, both the rise of the output voltage as well as the fall follows the linear variation. And that is also true if we have a pulse waveform like this. If you have a pulse waveform like this, so this is input V in T. So you have to integrate this thing from 0 to capital T. And if you integrate the some constant thing, because this is constant, between 0 to capital T, this is becoming constant. The input is constant. So therefore, if you integrate the constant thing, you'll be getting some linear function. In a nutshell, we can say that any low-pass filter with the RC time constant much, much larger can serve the purpose of an integrator circuit. And as far as the frequency behavior is concerned, for a low-pass filter to behave like an integrator, the higher cutoff frequency, which is given by 1 by twice pi RC, it should be as small as possible. That means the bandwidth of the low-pass filter would be very small. And if it can pass only the lower frequency components, if this FH is much, much smaller, like might be in the range of few tens of hertz, or even small, or hundreds of hertz, then we can regard this low-pass filter as an ideal low-pass filter, that it can pass only the lowest frequency within the circuit. So we can say that an ideal low-pass filter can serve the purpose of an integrator. Now, coming back to this high-pass filter, we know that this expression for the lower cutoff frequency is given by 1 by twice pi RC. So now, here the concept is a little bit different. Here, if I consider that this RC product, RC time constant, if it is much, much smaller as compared to this capital T, then what happens? the corresponding lower cutoff frequency FL is shifting towards the higher frequency sides. That means if you reduce the value of RC, or if the RC time constant is small with respect to this capital T, then obviously with the reduction of this RC, the value of FL will be shifted in the right hand side. And accordingly, what happens? We are selecting a very lower value of the time constant. What is the physical significance or physical implication of having a lower RC time constant? So to understand the physical implication, we have to consider the circuit once again over here. Now initially, let us assume that the capacitor is uncharged. There is no voltage drop across the two plates of the capacitor. Now, whenever some voltage is being applied, then the capacitor will try to attain that voltage, but it requires some time. And that time is identified by the time constant, that is RC. Now, if the RC time constant is very small, then momentarily the capacitor, which is there in the path, the momentarily this capacitor can achieve or can attain this voltage which has been applied, the input voltage. I don't know what about the input voltage, it can be anything. It can be a pulse waveform, or it can be a square wave or anything. But the capacitor, if the RC time constant is very small, then the capacitor will momentarily try to attain that value. So we can say that this voltage drop between the two plates of the capacitor can be written like V in T. Then what about the current that is flowing? Some current is flowing through the circuit, say IT. So then you know the relationship between the current and the voltage developed. So then this current IT can be written as C dVc by dt. Now, since the time constant is very small, so we can write like I is equal to C dV dt, and that V is nothing but the input voltage, because the time constant is very small and the capacitor can very quickly achieve the input voltage, or quickly trap input voltage. So IT can be represented like C times dV into dt. And what about the output voltage? It's a simple resistive network over here. So the output voltage is nothing but the current that is flowing through the circuit multiplied with the resistance. So we can write the output voltage, that is V out T, is equal to R times IT. So that gives you RC times dV into dt. So therefore, finally, we have arrived to a circuit, something like that. We have, let us consider the RC network is nothing but a two-port network. And I don't know what is there inside. So I think in the previous slide also, I should mention that intrigue it. And similarly here also, we have V out, and the operation is the differentiation operation. So this RC high pass network consisting of simple resistance and a capacitance, it can do the operation of a differentiator. The only condition is that the RC time constant here, the RC time constant should be as small as possible, unlike the low pass filter. For low pass filter, we have seen that if the RC time constant is much, much larger, then it can perform or it can behave like an integrator. And here, the RC time constant should be very small with respect to the time, so that it can perform the operation of a differentiator. That means the input-output relationship for this particular circuit, the output can be represented as a scaled version of the differentiation of the input. If the input is like Vin, then DDT of Vin multiplied with RC, so that is the scaling part, that gives you the V out. So the differentiation operation can be accomplished by means of a simple high pass network if the RC time constant is much, much smaller. Now, coming back to our analysis, suppose let us assume that once again we apply a pulse, a rectangular pulse of duration, say capital T. So this is your V in T. So this value is V, for example, and this duration is capital T. I should just change this one. Yeah, this is capital T, so the pulse duration is capital T. Now, what happens if the time constant, if RC time constant is much, much smaller, if RC is much, much smaller as compared to capital T? You know what is the relationship here? The V out T, can be written like V into e to the power minus T by RC. That is the formula. Now here the RC time constant, this one, is much, much smaller as compared to capital T. So then this fall happens at a much faster rate. And accordingly, if we just draw the output voltage, in fact, we have described this thing in detail in the last class. So this fall is, very quick. And it looks something like that. And then it comes back to the zero level. And once again, over here, there is a negative peak minus V, and ultimately looks something like that. So plus V to minus V. So this pulse waveform can be viewed as a combination of different impulse waveform. A number of impulses taken together can give you the notion of a pulse. And whenever you go on differentiating some pulse waveform, if you differentiate a pulse waveform, you're supposed to get an impulse. But you cannot really get an impulse by means of a physical circuit, because the idea of impulse or idea of unit impulse is hypothetical. You cannot really generate the unit impulse, but what you can do is you can closely approximate some impulse function. So differentiating any pulse waveform, you can get impulse. And this differentiation operation could have been accomplished by means of a simple RC high pass network with the condition that the RC time constant should be much, much smaller as compared to the time duration of the pulse, so that the capacitor, this capacitor, can charge up to this V value very quickly. And as you know, the output voltage is nothing but the input voltage minus the voltage across the two plates of the capacitor. So if the capacitor can very quickly charge up to this value, that is capital V, then the output voltage or voltage across the resistance can drop towards zero very quickly. So this can be accomplished over here. So ultimately, from this discussion, what we can understand is an RC low-pass filter and RC high-pass filter can serve the purpose of an integrator and differentiator, but with two different conditions. When the RC time constant pertaining to a low-pass network is much, much larger, then it can serve the purpose of an integrator. And similarly, for a high-pass network, if the RC time constant is much, much smaller with respect to the time, then this RC high-pass network would give you the notion of a differentiator. So we can say that an ideal low-pass filter can behave like an integrator, and an ideal high-pass filter can behave like a differentiator. So with this, we can conclude the discussion on this RC low-pass filter, RC high-pass filter. Now we can have some small discussion, brief discussion on the attenuator circuit. And perhaps you know what is meant by attenuator. So unlike an amplifier, the purpose of the attenuator is to reduce the amplitude of the signal. So normally these attenuators are composed of simple resistive elements. And as long as they are made of resistive elements, so as you understand, these are basically frequency insensitive circuits. So let me just consider an attenuator having two different resistance like this. And in fact, this particular circuit is frequency insensitive because, so let me consider this to be R1, this to be R2. And we apply some input voltage between these two terminal and the output voltage between these two terminal we are getting. And it's very simple to get the output as a function of the input. So we know that this output can be written as R2 by R1 plus R2. So a simple voltage divider law multiplied with the input voltage. Now, since this R1 and R2, they are not a function of frequency. So this output voltage, so if I consider that output as a function of some input, f of V in, so this f function, this function does not change with the frequency. So even if you change the input frequency from say 1 kilohertz to 10 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz to say 20 kilohertz, 20 kilohertz to say megahertz or megahertz to gigahertz, this particular factor R2 upon R1 by R2 will remain as it is. So in general, we can say that the attenuator circuit is not at all frequency sensitive. So it's a frequency insensitive network. But sometimes the purpose of an attenuator, sometimes we want that this attenuator or output of the attenuator should be fed to the input of any amplifier circuit. So let me just consider a situation like this. Suppose you have some, we have some attenuator over here. So we have some attenuator over here, and suppose you are feeding it to some amplifying devices. And whenever we talk about some amplifying devices, so as you know, it is composed of a transistor, for example, and you have a number of resistance and capacitances. And as a matter of fact, whenever you connect these two terminal, I mean the output terminal of the attenuator, so suppose this is the combined diagram. So as long as you connect this to output terminal of the attenuator to the input terminal of an amplifier, then the amplifier must exhibit some input resistance and as well as some input capacitance. And that input capacitance resulting from the amplifier will load the output side of the attenuator. So accordingly, this network, so we can have some resistance. So we don't have any problem with the resistance, because if we have some input resistance of the amplifier and it is coming in shunt, so overall input resistance or overall resistance over here can be simply written like the shunt combination, the parallel combination of this R2 and the input resistance of the amplifier. There is no problem about that. But we don't have any explicit capacitor over here. So that's why this attenuator circuit was frequency insensitive. But for some reason, for some application, if you want to connect this attenuator to some amplifying devices and for with some input capacitance is here, whenever you connect this attenuator output over here, so some capacitor will be there. And that is coming in shunt with R2. So let me call this capacitor as C2. Now, when you connect this capacitor, when the capacitor is there, then the output of the attenuator is not at all frequency insensitive, because this capacitor is a frequency sensitive device. So accordingly, the output of the attenuator is no longer a frequency insensitive. So how to make the attenuator circuit insensitive to the frequency operation? Now, for this particular purpose, you have to compensate the effect of this capacitor by means of adding another capacitor in shunt with this R1. So you have initially you have these two resistances R1 and R2. in the attenuator, and whenever you observe this attenuator in isolation, then there is no problem because both of them, both R1 and R2, their frequency insensitive, and the output voltage is a function of the input voltage, but it's not a function of the input frequency. Irrespective of the input frequency, the corresponding attenuation, the attenuating factor, is always given by R2 by R1 plus R2. But for some application, if you want to connect this attenuator to some amplifying devices, and because of the presence of the input capacitance, so then this C2 will come into picture. And accordingly, now we cannot write V out as a function of V in, and which function is insensitive to frequency. So ultimately, this output V out will be a function of the input frequency as well. So we have to compensate the effect of this capacitor, and this compensation is being done by adding another capacitor in shunt with R1. So how does the circuit look like then? So we have a circuit like this. Initially we have this resistance, initially we have this R1, and this R2, if you have some input resistance of the amplifier, so that can be taken into account within this R2 itself. But the capacitor has to be treated separately. So this is the capacitor, and we have to compensate the effect of this capacitor by connecting another capacitor in shunt with this R1. So this one is R1, this one is R2. Let me call this one as C1, this one as C2. And let us see whether this circuit can compensate the effect. That means whether this circuit, this output voltage, whether this is insensitive to the frequency operation or not. So that you have to check. So what we can do is we can redraw this circuit, and this can be done like this. We can redraw this entire circuit just like this. We have this is the two ports of input, and we have two capacitors over here, C1 and C2. I'm just redrawing the previous circuit. These two resistances, R1 and R2. So this one is C1, this one is C2, this one is R1, this one is R2. And this voltage between these two terminal, this two node is Vin, and between these two node, that voltage is Vout. So I'm just redrawing the previous circuit. Let us check it once more. So we are applying the input over here between these two terminal. So one terminal over here, R1, and then you have R2, that is fine. R1, R2, series combination like this. And then we have this C1, C2 series combination like this. And these two points are connected together because we have R1, C1 parallel combination and R2, C2 parallel combination. So let me call this point as node X and this point as node Y. And the output is taken across these two nodes. Now, this particular arrangement, it looks like a bridge. It looks like a bridge, and accordingly, the overall output voltage will no longer be a function of the frequency if the potential at these two terminal is kept same. That means Vx, if Vx equal to Vy, if these two potentials are same, then we can verify that the output voltage will simply not be a function of the input frequency. That means the output voltage can be written as the function of these two resistances, that is R1 and R2. So as long as the output voltage is not a function of C1 and C2, which are frequency sensitive devices, then obviously we can say that the output voltage is not a function of frequency. Now that can only be achieved if the potential at the terminal X and the potential at the terminal Y being the same. So for that, we have to apply the rule for balancing these two potential. So if this voltage equal to V in, then the component over here, so now we have this R1, R2 in series combination, and we are measuring the voltage across R2. And here C1 and C2 is in series combination, and we are measuring the voltage across C2. But remember, for resistance, whenever they are in a series combination, the equivalent resistance given by R1 plus R2. But for capacitance, it is C1 C2 upon C1 plus C2. So the condition which has to be satisfied over here is that this R2 upon R1 plus R2, that must be equal to C1 by C1 plus C2. Now, if this condition gets satisfied, then there is no difference between these two nodes, that is, I mean, between these two potential at X and Y. And if we solve this one, what we find? We find R2 C1. I think we can go to the next slide. So R2 by R1 plus R2 must be equal to C1 by C1 plus C2. So the condition is R2 by R1 plus R2 must be equal to C1 by C1 plus C2. So R2 C1 plus R2 C2 is equal to R1 C1 plus R2 C1. From where R2 C1 can get cancelled, and ultimately we are left with R1 C1 is equal to R2 C2. Now this is known as the perfect compensation, and accordingly we have to select the value of C1, because in the attenuator circuit previously we know what is R1 and what is R2, but we don't have any idea regarding C2, because for the same attenuator circuit, whenever it has been fed to different amplifying devices, the value of the input capacitance can be different. So the C2 is not the same. We know R1, we know R2, the C2 is not the same. So we have to, accordingly, we have to tune the value of C1 so that this condition gets established. That means R1, C1, this product is equal to R2, C2. So accordingly, we have to adjust the value of C1, the compensating capacitor that you have connected in parallel with R1, so that this condition is valid. That is, R1, C1 product is equal to R2, C2. Now under this condition, what we find, there is no potential, I mean, there is no potential difference between the X and Y, the potential at X and the potential at Y being the same. So we can simply cut this if you connect some voltmeter over here, you'll see that there is no deflection. That means the potential at these two nodes being the same. And once again, the V out value can be written as R2 by R1 plus R2 into V in, although we have a C1 and C2 explicitly present in this circuit. Now this is known as, this particular condition is known as the condition for perfect compensation. So if you achieve this one, this is known as the condition for perfect compensation. So this is known as the perfect compensation. This is known as a perfect compensation. But sometimes the value of C1, because since you are tuning the value of C1, you cannot achieve this perfect compensation at the very beginning. So sometimes you can have a situation like what is known as the overcompensation, sometimes what is known as undercompensation. So let us try to understand what is meant by this overcompensation and what is meant by the undercompensation. So you have a capacitive and resistive network like this. And suppose we are applying some SysTF function, for example. So we're applying some SysTF function. So at t is equal to 0, so this one is R1, this one is R2, this one C1, this one C2, and we are measuring the output between these two nodes. V out, and this one is V in. And suppose we are applying some step input over here with the magnitude of V. That is V in. So at t is equal to 0 minus, the input voltage was 0, and at t is equal to 0 plus, the input voltage is V. That means if you just observe within the range, say 0 minus to 0 plus, within this particular, if I consider the time within that particular range, that is 0 minus to 0 plus, there is a certain fluctuation of the input voltage from 0 to V, and that fluctuation occurs within a very short span of time. So you cannot measure that time. So mathematically, we can say that it is 0 minus and 0 plus. So at 0 minus, input voltage was 0, and at 0 plus, input voltage was V. And within this short span of time, the capacitor, the C1-C2 combination, so it will experience this sudden change in the input voltage. And initially, these two capacitors, C1 and C2, will be short-circuited because of this sudden change of the input voltage. So initially, these two capacitors will be short-circuited. And accordingly, we can measure what about the corresponding output potential developed over here, and which is known as the V out at 0 plus. So in fact, there will be a finite charge developed in each of these capacitors. And if I consider that the voltage developed across C1 is V1, and the voltage developed across C2 is V2, then this V1 plus V2 must be equal to V. V1 plus V2 must be equal to V. And what about the voltage developed across C1? So that V1 can be written as Q1 upon C1, and that V2 can be written as Q2 upon C2. But remember, since the same current is being flown, so we can write that Q1 and Q2, they are the same. So we can write V1 to be Q upon C1, and V2 to be Q upon C2. So what about the output voltage at t is equal to 0 plus? Whenever you just plug in the input voltage, and input voltage makes a sharp transition from 0 to V, what about the input voltage? What about the output voltage? Output voltage is given by, which we call like V out at 0 plus. V out at 0 plus. So that is nothing but V multiplied with C1 upon C1 plus C2. But as the time progresses, then there is no change in input voltage. Essentially, it's a DC one. Beyond t is equal to 0 plus, you find that there is no change in input voltage. Input voltage remains constant. So therefore, now the capacitors, these two capacitors, C1 and C2, they will provide infinite impedance to the input voltage. And then the steady state output voltage can be obtained from the steady state output, which you can call like V out infinity. The steady state output can be written like V into R2 by R1 plus R2. One is the initial output voltage that is governed by the C1-C2 combination. And second one is the steady state output voltage, that is R2 by R1 plus R2. Now, if these two are same, that means V out 0 plus equal to V out infinity, then what we have called this particular condition is perfect compensation. So this is time. So this is your input voltage level. Let me call that V. and the output voltage. This we call Vout plus, Vout zero plus. We call this as Vout zero plus, and this voltage is Vout infinity, and both of them are equal. So to make sense that these two are same, so we have to check that C1 by C1 plus C2, that must be equal to R2 by R1 plus R2. So from that, you can verify that C1 is given by R2 C2 upon R1. That means the concept of perfect compensation. But sometimes it may happen because of the variable value of C1. The initial value of C1 could have been large as compared to the optimum value. If I call this value to be the C opt, let me call this as C opt, an optimum value for the capacitor C1. Now sometimes the initial value of the capacitor C1 might be larger than C opt. Then what will be the corresponding fluctuation? Then it will be something like that. So this is the input voltage level L and V, and initial value of the output voltage is large with respect to the final value, final steady state value. And so there is a fluctuation like this. So accordingly, you can mark what is V out zero plus and what is V out infinite. So this one is V out zero plus. And this one is V out infinite. And the condition is the value of C1 should be greater than C opt. And this is known as the overcompensation. This is the perfect compensation. Perfect compensation. And this one is known as the overcompensation. Because the initial value of C1 was larger as compared to the optimum value. And similarly, we can have the third situation where the value of C1 is small as compared to the optimum value. So suppose this is the level of the input voltage. And initially the value is small, and then this is the ultimate value, final value. This one is constant, this one is fixed. We can call this as V out infinity, and we can call this as V out zero plus. Now here this situation is known as the situation of undercompensation. The condition is C1 is less than C out, and this is known as undercompensation. This one is known as undercompensation. Now forget about this perfect compensation. It's very difficult to achieve perfect compensation at the very beginning. Now if I consider this overcompensation and undercompensation, as you see the variation from the V out zero plus to V out infinity. So this variation takes place not linearly, but it will follow some exponential variation. And this exponential variation is because of the presence of the effective value of the resistance and the effective value of the capacitor. Now, what will be the time constant of this particular fluctuation from V out zero plus to V out infinity? So that time constant you can readily obtain just by observing this particular compensator attenuator circuit. So in order to obtain the time constant, what is done you have to make these two terminal at the same potential. That means it should be short circuited. And looking at the output terminal, you have to identify the effective value of the resistance and the effective value of the capacitor. And what about the effective value of the resistance? The effective value of the resistance is nothing but R1, R2 parallel combination, because you are looking from this terminal, you are looking from this. This is the output terminal. You are looking from this terminal. So between these two terminals, you have R2 and you have another resistance R1, because this is short circuited. These two nodes are shorted. So therefore, the effective resistance is given by R2 parallel R1, R1 R2 parallel combination. And what about the effective value of the capacitor? So the effective value of the capacitor is also the parallel combination of C1 and C2. And here, since we have a capacitor, so the C effective value will be nothing but the summation of the two capacitors, that is C1 plus C2. So the overall time constant of the, if you measure the corresponding rise time, it's nothing but 2.2 times of the RC product. So R is nothing but this, so we can write over here the corresponding, the rise time. So the rise time, so the expression for the rise time for this circuit, TR, can be written as 2.2 times RC. So already we have developed, derived the expression for the time, rise time, that is 2.2 times RC, where R here is nothing but the parallel combination of R1 and R2, that means R1, R2 upon R1 plus R2, this one. And the effective C is given by C1 plus C2. And accordingly, we can have the expression for the rise time, that is 2.2 times RC. Normally, the value of these two resistances is R1 and R2. They are normally very large, because if the value of the resistance is large, if I go back over here, yes, in this particular slide, if we consider that R1 R2 is very large, then it will not load the corresponding input signal. That means the corresponding input impedance provided by the RC circuit, provided by this R1 R2 attenuator circuit, is much larger. And that is our objective for any electronic system design, that the input impedance for any voltage amplifier, if I consider the input impedance, so that input impedance should be as large as possible, so that the loading, the loss due to loading, gets minimized. So here the effective value of the input impedance or input resistance provided by this attenuator circuit is given by R1 R2 parallel combination, that is R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. So normally the value of this individual value of these resistances R1 and R2, they are very large. So as a matter of fact, the loading effect can be minimized and the signal loss can be minimized. So that is the advantageous part. If I select the individual value of R1 R2 very large, then the loading effect can be minimized, because you may argue that it ultimately doesn't depend upon the individual value, because it's nothing but R2 by R1 plus R2. But you have to ensure that whenever we find out the overall gain or attenuation resulting from any circuit, not only the exact value, but also the rate at which you are attaining that value is also important. So normally, to reduce the loading effect, to reduce the signal loss, the individual value for this R1 and R2 must be very large. So that is the advantageous part from the circuit designer's perspective. But the problematic point is that we have already derived the expression for the time constant, this rise time. And this rise time is given by 2.2 times RC. So if you select a very high value of the resistance, if R1 and R2, if both of them are very large, so in that case, the corresponding time constant, the corresponding rise time is also very large. So we have to achieve certain means so that this time constant or this entire thing can be minimized. But at the same time, you have to understand that there is a kind of optimization problem. There is a kind of trade-off problem, because if you want to achieve one particular objective from the perspective of the system designer, from the perspective of circuit designer, if you want to achieve one thing, then obviously you are going to lose the other thing. And so that is the one of the disadvantages associated with this particular design. But you have to understand that for perfect compensation, this the output voltage at 0 plus and the output voltage at infinite must be same. And in this entire analysis, we have also made one assumption that the infinite amount of current will flow through the capacitors at t is equal to 0 plus. And as a matter of fact, the capacitors can get the charge instantaneously. Now, that is only true if the corresponding generator resistance is zero. So what do you mean by the generator resistance? That means we have these two capacitors like C1 and C2. And apart from that, we are having some input signal over here. So that input is being supplied by some source. So whenever we consider that source, let me call this source. So we do have some source over here, which provides input voltage. And so this is plus minus Vin. And accordingly, whenever we do have some voltage source, so automatically it is also accompanied with some source resistance. It is also accompanied with some source resistance, that is R of S. Now, if this R of S, ideally if it is zero, then what happens? The capacitor, the C1 and C2, can be charged up instantaneously if this RS is equal to zero. But here also, if the value of RS is non-zero, then you cannot say that this capacitor, the C1 and C2, can be charged instantaneously. And accordingly, once again, there is a notion of RC time constant. Here also, we do have a notion of RC time constant. So here, the value of the capacitor, I mean, the effective value of the capacitor is nothing but C1, C2 parallel combination, and the effective value of the resistance is nothing but RS. Now, from that, you can have what is meant by the V0, 0 plus. That means at time t is equal to 0 plus, what is the output voltage? And then the steady state value of the output is governed by these two resistances, that is R1 and R2. And that variation from the steady state, from the initial value of the output to the steady state value, that variation is done by means of some exponential function. And in connection to this exponential function, we do have certain RC product, RC time constant, and that RC time constant can be obtained from this R1 R2 parallel combination and C1 C2 parallel combination. So it is given by R is equal to R1 R2 R1 plus R2 and C is equal to C1 plus C2. Now, if this individual value of R1 R2 is large, then the corresponding time taken by the overall circuit to settle down to the output voltage will be to some extent larger. For example, if I consider a scenario where this RC time constant is much small, then this variation from the output from the initial to the final output can be obtained at a very faster rate. So it can be like this. So at a very faster rate, it can settle down to the final output. So this can be due to a faster RC. Here also, you can have a situation like this. It can settle down to the output value. I mean, the final output, the steady state output, at a much faster rate, faster RC. That means the corresponding time constant, this RC product, should be small. With this, I would like to conclude our today's discussion on attenuator circuit. And before discussing the attenuator circuit today, I have also mentioned how we can use a simple RC low-pass filter as an integrator by choosing a very high value of the RC time constant, and how can we use a simple RC high-pass filter as a differentiator by selecting a very small value of RC time constant. So ultimately, the behavior of each of the circuit is very much dependent upon the selection of the R and C value. So these are the basic components of an RC network. And depending upon the corresponding selection of the R and C value, and this RC product must also be compared with the time duration of the input signal. And based on the comparison, we can have the different conditions, and we have explicitly mentioned the different conditions in the last few lectures. So with this, I would like to conclude our today's discussion on attenuator circuit.